were never right for daylight. All that you sought here has disappeared into the great blue light of day. Although you try, my dear one, I know you try to touch the sun.
His favorite thing, but you got nowhere to go and you won't be getting there fast. Cause traffic sucks, you look up what happened to all that time you used to have. You got another 57 minutes sit there feeling bad. yourself a new idea. A good love, a true career. Gotta put your mind on something that makes you feel good. If this were the last day of your life, you gotta make it the best day of your life. Let's say it's the last day of your life. You gotta make it the best day. Get it right. 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 Get it. Get it right. Get it right. Get it right. Get it right. Angie works the tightrope. She's a circus superstar. You will find her amazing. It don't matter who you are. For the old and jaded, she's the best thing that they've got. Everybody loves her if they wanted to or not. Even if she stumbles, you won't see her looking down. She never finds her answers on the ground. She's not afraid. She's not afraid of falling. She's not afraid of falling.
Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation at Montclair, and Happy New Year. My name is Marcus Greyhawk. My pronouns are he, him, and his. I serve as the Director of Music Ministries for our congregation, and it's good to be with you once again. If you are watching this service live on YouTube or Facebook, we invite you to let us and each other know that you are here by typing your name and, if you wish, your location into the comment section. The hymn we have chosen to start each service this month is We'll Build a Land, written under the title Creation of Peace by Carolyn McDade. The lyricist Barbara Zanotti put together verses scripture verses from the prophets Isaiah and Amos to call us to envision and create the beloved community that our world so desperately needs. We invite you to join us and sing along. Our hymn leader today is Loris Greyhawk.
Oh, Whoever you are, wherever you come from, whatever age, identity, history, ability, gender, sexual orientation, or political affiliation, you are welcome to bring your full self here. I'm Reverend Scott Sandler Michael, he, him, his.
And I'm Reverend Anya Sandler Michael, she, her, and hers. Grounded in faith, we come together to nurture the soul, inspire hope, and bring into being a more just and loving world.
Today's service, titled, I'm Going to Make It Through This Year, is a service that I imagine most of us can relate to, a service that invites us into a space of resilience as well as transformation. This is a service that welcomes the new year as it invites us to release with gratitude and grace the past.
And we will be graced today by the vision and wisdom of two of our own members, Laura Anthony, the head of our worship team, and Charles Laughlin, currently a seminarian at Meadville Lombard Theological School. Both offer wisdom from a place of embodied calling. We are blessed to have them hold us with their words and lead us with their understanding.
So if you're joining us at 10 a.m., please continue with us for a virtual connection cafe on Zoom beginning at 11 a.m. Check your email and realm announcements for that Zoom link.
And it's time now to light our chalice, a beacon to guide us through these times together. And today we begin by sharing our amended chalice lighting words. These new words, proposed by member Ann Saylor, and today sung by the same, and reviewed by you, dear congregation, and embraced by our ministry team, offer a more inclusive message. The second two lines remain, but the first has been amended to invite us to not only open our eyes, but to engage all of our senses. This message speaks to all of us and reaches to champion the experiences of those among us who do not have use of their sense of sight.
Perhaps you have a chalice or a candle at home, anything that you can illumine.
So let's light our collective chalices as we share our chalice lighting affirmation.
Let us open our senses to take in the beauty. Let us open our minds to learn what is true. Let us open our hearts to love one another. To love one another. Let us open our senses to take in the beauty. Let us open our minds to learn what is true. Let us open our hearts to love one another. To love one another.
Our invocation was written by Ashley Horan, and it invites us to imagine that other world, that another world, is possible. Ashley shares, another world is possible. We say it again and again, even when the proof lies somewhere beyond the horizon, beyond our reach, beyond our imagination. This is our faith. Another world is possible. There are many routes towards liberation, toward freedom. But the abundance of options does not absolve us of the responsibility of acting. Another world is possible. Called now by this invocation into worship, we turn to seek a soft meditation, a deep reflection, an ardent prayer. Each as we are called, yet all together. And we enter into this space by hearing the lamentations, the requests, and the remembrances of our community. Let us hear one another to heal one another. The voice you will hear sharing these candles is our member and seminarian, Charles Laughlin.
We light this candle of mourning for Alfonso LaFalce, Jackie Leahy's father who died on Wednesday morning. Please hold the LaFalce and the Leahy family in your prayers. This ache is compounded as Jackie's mother died in April. We light this candle of healing for Jessie, niece to our office and communications manager, Jacqueline Paleo, who was just diagnosed with COVID-19. We light this candle for Catherine Rue, Judith Rue's mother-in-law, who is providing care to her husband, Bob Rue, at home. He is recovering from a stroke and was not faring well in a nursing home. We light this candle for the Pipkins family that is still recovering from COVID-19. Chantel is up and back to work, but still feeling fatigue. We light this candle for the city of Nashville, for those injured in the blast, and for those who work tirelessly to ensure the safety of those in the blast site. We also light this candle in recognition of the pain that fuels terror, adding our prayer for all who ache and feel they have no witness. May healing come. We light this candle for the children of 2020. Honor is often bestowed on the first babies born in a new year. And with this candle, we recognize all of the children born in the year that has just passed. With all we are moved to say about 2020, we light this candle to remember all the blessings the year brought, including many, many new and beautiful lives. We light this final candle for the joys and sorrows that have not been spoken aloud. In the silence that follows, you are encouraged to speak the names of those you are holding in your prayers or meditations, or to write them into the chat. May we hold this silence as this silence holds us. May our listening bring forth acts of love. I invite you to join me in a spirit of prayer and meditation. Spirit of life, spirit of the days and years that have been, as well as spirit of what yet may be, spirit of that which is always continuously becoming, we pause for the possibility of experience. The change of a calendar year is a threshold, an invitation to reflect on where we have been, to imagine where we can go, and perhaps most importantly, to fully inhabit the present moment. Like every other day, we arrive bearing both our joys and sorrows in carefully crafted bundles. Perhaps we can, if even for a moment, lay them down here for a short rest. Assuredly, they will be here still should we choose to bring them along for the continuing journey. For some, the weight of both the joys and sorrows may catch us by surprise. There are so many things that we surely thought we would need to get here just to survive. And maybe this is a time as good as any to take a quick inventory. Some of these things have journeyed with us for a very long time, and others we've accumulated along the way. Some we can name: loss, weariness, fear, love, hope, faith, perhaps. We feel them again, even as we name them. They are a part of us. Some we may not be ready to name, and that's okay. Those can wait for another day. We may choose right now to let some of these go. On the threshold of what tomorrow might bring, we can decide today, like every day, how to continue this journey. And maybe, just maybe, this time we will begin again in a spirit of particular humility, recognizing how incorrect so many of our expectations from the last year proved to be. But at the threshold, the spirit that continuously becomes invites us to reimagine, to reinvent, and to recreate. In that, there is beauty, a profound mystery, awe, and wonder. And one last thing we may want to do before continuing this journey is to pause and look around and acknowledge our fellow travelers. Although we may sometimes forget it, we do not journey alone. Thresholds are also opportunities to regather with our companions, maybe even to redistribute some of those joys and sorrows. And when we are ready, we can continue together with the spirit of what may yet be. May it indeed be so.
There is more love. There is. When you give to our offering, 80% of our gifts care for the Unitarian Universalist Congregation at Montclair, and 20% will support our Justice recipient. Our January Sharing Our Riches recipient is RIP Medical Debt, Essex County, a campaign developed by the Montclair Interfaith Clergy Association. Together, we have the opportunity to eliminate the medical debt for hundreds of families and individuals in Essex County. We will be helping families who earn less than 2 times the federal poverty level, have debts that are 5% or more of their annual income, and those whose debts are greater than their assets. Through this campaign, every dollar that we give will abolish $100 of medical debt. You can text to give, mail us a check, or go to our homepage and click on the donate button. This is a time of need. All of your gifts are worthy, and they are all received with love. We move now to our reading. This piece by the American poet Aracelis Grimaud, titled You Are Who I Love, has been adapted for our worship. You, selling roses out of a silver grocery cart. You, in the park, feeding the pigeons. You, cheering for the bees. You, protecting the river. You are who I love. Delivering babies, nursing the sick. You, with henna on your feet and a gold star in your nose. You, taking your medicine, reading the magazines. You, looking into the faces of young people as they pass, smiling and saying, all right. You, dancing in the kitchen, on the sidewalk, in the subway, waiting for the train because Stevie Wonder, Hector Lavoe, La Lupe. You, stirring the pots of beans. You, washing your father's feet, reciting Darwish, then June. Feeding your heart, teaching your parents how to do the Dougie, counting to 10. Reading your patient's charts, you are who I love. Changing policies, standing in the line for water, stocking the food pantries, making a meal. You are who I love. Writing letters, calling the senators, you who with the seconds of your body, with your time here, arrive on buses, on trains, in cars, by foot, to stand in the January streets against the cool and brutal offices saying, your cruelty does not speak for me. You, who the borders crossed, you dissent with rage, so in love with the earth, you writing poems alongside children, you summoning the courage, making the cobbler, getting the blood drawn, sharing the difficult news. You always planting the marigolds, learning to walk wherever you are, learning to read wherever you are. You baking the bread, speaking to your children in your mother's language, tooting the birds. You are who I love. You who beat and did not beat the odds. You who knows that any good thing you have is the result of someone else's sacrifice. Work. You who fight for reparations. You wanting to listen. You trying to be so still. You in the brightness and in the darkness. Throwing your hands back as you laugh. You are who I love. Crossing the desert and trying to cross the desert. You are who I love. Working the shifts to buy the books, rice, tomatoes. Bathing your children as you listen to the lecture. Heating the kitchen with the oven. Up early, up late. You are who I love. Learning English, learning Spanish, drawing flowers on your hands with a ballpoint pen, taking the bus home. You are who I love. Speaking plainly about your pain, sucking your teeth at the airport terminal television, you are who I love. Throwing your hands up in agony or disbelief, shaking your head, arguing back, out loud or inside of yourself, holding close your incredulity, which yes, too, I love. I love your working heart, how each of its gestures, tiny or big, stand besides my own agony, building a fortress there. You, at the edges and shores, in the rooms of quiet, in the rooms of shouting, in the airport terminal, at the bus depot, saying no, and each of us looking out for the gorgeous unlikelihood of our lives at all. Finding ourselves here, witnesses to each other's tenderness, which this moment is fury, is rage, which this moment is another way of saying, you are who I love. You are who I love. You and you and you are who.
You're over 2020, right? You're over and past it. It is January 3rd of 2021, and we are collectively done. I submit as evidence, if you ask my roommate what she got for Christmas this year, she'll reach down and tug up her pant leg and show you a pair of bright green socks that say, well, we're in church. They say something to the effect of forget 2020. And searching that phrase, or something close to it, yields dividends, right? You can get mugs and Christmas tree ornaments and t-shirts and cake toppers and candles and more Christmas tree ornaments and masks and headbands and those New Year's Eve party eyeglasses that I believe are just usually in the shape of the coming year. But this time they're a goodbye to the past year that we all just lived through. Imagine that. How suffused we are, how tired. And, like, there's a shelf life on all that merch, right? But that's not the point. The point is that you're done with it. And this is the perfect time for a fire communion, right? Fire communion is a Unitarian Universalist tradition. Its origins are unclear, but vaguely pagan. Under the flaming chalice, you write down what you need to release in the new year and set it aflame. You name your intentions to change, but moreover, you decide what needs to be destroyed, or in the very least, left behind. So here we are. And perhaps you've been waiting for this moment, right? Forget 2020. There's so much we need to release. I would like to propose to you something, though. That in this fire communion, where now more than ever we would like to cast a whole year onto the fire, there is so much more that we need from it as we move into 2021. There are small things. Getting in the car after picking up a few things from the grocery store, a friend fished in his center console, squirted his hands with a tiny bottle of alcohol, and then without thinking, held up the little container to me. And at the same time, I've already pulled my vial from a deep pocket of my coat and washed up to hand it to him. And while the alcohol cooled on our skin, we laughed at that little dance, and he said, "Well, that's one thing that's gonna last after all this." And what he meant was that he won't go to a grocery store without hand sanitizer anymore, but I heard it with something else, with the knowledge that there is a unity here, a new one. We defend each other. There are bigger things to take than hand sanitizer. There's a spark. There's a knowledge, a power from somewhere, a hope. I am going to make it through this year. Do you feel that? I am going to make it through this year. Say it with me, because you are too. I am going to make it through this year. How do I know? We made it through the last one. In spite of everything. And I do mean everything. Look, we went through it. In January of 2020, we almost tipped into a third world war. Do you remember that? It happened. Not just in the Twitter offhanded comment from a delinquent president way. We were actually at a fairly considerable risk of it. Just this time last year. But you might have forgotten about it, given that since then there has been a plague and nationwide protesting. And what future historians will surely call a blatant and unsophisticated attempt at a coup by parties who have no interest in giving up power, even when we have called them down. The place at which my family annually purchases a smoked turkey sent us a postcard on the day we were supposed to receive our smoked turkey, saying that the entire smoked turkey warehouse caught fire, and the entire year's worth of product had gone up in smoke. My mom handed me the postcard, laughing and shrugging, and said, "Well, 2020. We have been separated from each other. We have lost the ability to hug and put hands on hands. Dinner parties and vacations and weddings. There has been pain in the extreme. And what we've lost has been great. Friends, family, I don't know how to give shape to those losses, how to make them make sense. They don't. And for your pain, for the grief that this year has brought you, I am sorry. I am so, so sorry. We've lost innocence of a certain kind. We've seen from the chasms of the web moments of unmasked grocery store standoffs. We have seen video after video of people in power using that power to crush. We have been heartbroken by it. And we still are. But poet Lucille Clifton wrote, "Come celebrate with me that every day something has tried to kill me and failed." And this past year, I've found myself thinking it about us. When I think of the caliber of disaster this year has been, the apocalypses that we as a people just seem to keep on sliding out of. I don't believe there's a benevolent God who keeps us safe. I don't believe there is a cosmic conspiracy to keep us on our collective feet. But we are going to make it through this year because we made it through the last one, because there is a divine and protective force in the world on the darkest days and the coldest nights that we can pray to. It's you. You have, in this past year, learned to sew and distribute masks at such a rate that there's bowls of them by front doors. You gave them away. And for every video of violence that shakes the foundations of what we've been taught, there's videos of teachers learning how to teach our young by conference call. My sister is doing it while raising two toddlers. And for though there was an astounding number of people who would be complicit in an authoritarian takeover if it meant some vague sensation of safety, we have proved definitively and to the numbers that there are way more of you. And here you've raised money and stayed home and argued with people on the internet. In the middle of one of the scariest moments in recent history, when injustice was done, you put on your mask and took to the street anyway. Because you had to, in the heat of summer, handing out water bottles and singing. We heard some of Aracelia Germay's poem, "You are who I love, you are who I love, you are who I love," writing letters, calling senators. You who, with the seconds of your body, with your time here, arrive in the January streets against the cruel and brutal offices and says, "Your cruelty does not speak for me." We are going to make it through this year because of you. Because you have proven that hate will be drowned out. Because you have proven that when we can't hold each other, we'll smile at each other. And when we can't be together, we will still be together. And I am so grateful for you. Grateful doesn't begin to get at the scope of what I am feeling. So yes, forget 2020. It was awful. It was almost unbelievably bad. But do not forget how you have become bright and brave, how you have seen this world for all its hate and wrapped your protective arms around her. How could we forget that? On this fire communion, let us remember that there is more to it than a need for release. After all, were we not forged in the fire? We cannot go back to how it was before. There is another thing that I think we should keep from 2020. We formed a new ritual, a ritual of taking our old rituals, our old traditions, and mulling them over and rolling them around and looking at them from all sides. Are they safe for everyone? Do they make sense given where we are now? Do they make us feel better? And in that spirit, let us take our fire communion. Let us evolve it for this particular moment. Take that slip of paper you readied and tear it in half. And on one half, take what you need from this past year. You could take resilience or serenity or the kindness of strangers or pragmatism or innovation. And hold that slip with you today. Keep it safe if you're moved. And let it touch your January. And maybe slowly trail into the new year that we will build together. And on the other, you can write what you're ready to release. What in the flame you will say goodbye to in 2021. And if you can safely burn that slip with us, feel free to do so. But there's all kinds of ways to let go and all kinds of good times to do so. So when you're ready, and you feel moved by fire or wind or water, let it go. You will have a moment of music to reflect and write. And then together we will sing our closing hymn, "The Fire of Commitment." Please join us in our fire communion. May you find blessings this year. And as it was last year, may they be way more powerful than any hurt. We're going to make it through this year. You and I, the way we made it through the last one. Together.
Our worship has ended. Let our service begin. Go in peace. Go in joy. Go in love.
If you are here for the premiere, then we invite you to join us for Connection Cafe. And don't forget to register your children for our innovative religious education programs. And finally, until we meet again, virtually or otherwise, you are in our hearts.
Down to fly away tightly now, tie her down before she sees there's no good reason to stay. Spread her wings out on the floor quickly now, tie her down before she sees.
Touch the sun, you've learned in time that on waxen wings you never can.
Walk the dog in an Isaac mask. And the dreams of the last days. Wash away the channel, eat an egg. Put your pants on one leg at a time. Like everybody never wanted nobody say. Love sucks, you messed up. That girl was the best thing you ever had. You got the rest of your life to feel bad. You walk in, look around. It's all quiet, except the sound of a couple hundred drones on a telephone. All you wanted was some peace of mind and a great big piece of the pie. What you got was a lot of nothing and a 30-year loan. Work sucks, you look up. What happened to that great idea you used to have? It's like a full-time occupation when you're feeling bad. If this were the last day of your life, would it be the best day of your life? You got 24 hours to get it right. Lunch hour, you eat alone. There's no one calling on your new iPhone, but you got the greatest hits and the latest bags. Can't wait for the bell to ring. It's always everybody's favorite thing. But you got nowhere to go and you won't be getting there fast. Cause traffic sucks, you look up. What happened to all that time you used to have? You got another 57 minutes sit there feeling bad. If this were the last day of your life, would it be the best day of your life? You got 24 hours to get it right. Ooh, get it right. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray to God that you don't weep over lost love, lost time, and dreams of food. Gotta get yourself a new idea, a good love, a true career. Gotta put your mind on something that makes you feel good. If this were the last day of your life, you gotta make it the best day of your life. Let's say it's the last day of your life. You gotta make it the best day. She's a circus superstar. You will find her amazing. It don't matter who you are. For the old and jaded, she's the best thing that they've got. Everybody loves her if they wanted to or not. Even if she stumbles, you won't see her looking down. She never finds her answers on the ground. She's not afraid. She's not afraid of falling. She's not afraid of falling. Down. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid.